Hello everyone, my name is Nikhil Reddy Mummadi and my senior design project is related to the investigation of electromigration failure time in graphene capped copper interconnects. So during the course of my presentation, I will be talking about the basic effects of electromigration, and I will be presenting some of the electromigration failure time of the various test structures that we built, and we'll be discussing about the trends that we observed in the process of analyzing the data. So a little bit about electromigration itself. Electromigration, or EM, is the effect of high electric field on wires that causes the metal atoms within wires to be migrated because of the flow of the high density of electrons. So this results in the formation of voids and hillocks or short circuits within the wires, which causes the circuits to have functional or timing failures. So this phenomenon has become a serious reliability issue in today's modern integrated circuits, especially with chips scaling down in the nanometer regime. So this phenomenon of electromigration failure time can be modeled using the Black's model, which is shown right here, which says that the failure time is dependent on the current density, the area of cross-section of the conductor, the temperature, and on other factors like the activation metal, like the activation energy of the metal. Here is a side view of a copper wire, which shows how the high density of electrons tend to create voids or hillocks within the wire. So now in modern integrated circuits, copper has replaced aluminium as it provides up to 5 times of greater breakdown current density as compared to aluminium. It also tends to reduce RC delays and prevents junction spiking. However, as a trade-off of using copper instead of aluminium, copper cannot be dry etched and it needs to be either wet etched or used lift off or CMP in order to pattern it. Copper also tends to have a polycrystalline grain structure at smaller nodes, which causes it to have a very high number of grain boundaries as shown in this figure. This increased grain boundaries cause copper to have a higher resistivity and also increased diffusion of copper atoms along the surface, grain boundaries, and the bulk of the copper. So here is a layout of all the test structures that were built as a part of the electromigration testing for this project. We used the standard 12 probe pad configuration. The minimum feature size was approximately 0.5 microns. And we had wires of different widths, from 0.5 to 1 to 2 micron. And we also included 90 degree angles and curved bends at some of the edges of the wires to observe any noticeable EM stress effects during the testing process. So the next follows is the fabrication flow that we followed to pattern the test structures that were used for EM testing. We started with a silicon wafer, a P-type silicon wafer, and grew 3000 angstroms of silicon dioxide over it. And then we coated it with LOR 5A or the lift-off resist 5A. And we coated another positive photoresist, which is the MIR 701, at the mentioned RPMs for the following these recipes. The next part was to expose this wafer over the ASML I-line stepper at an exposure dose of 275 millijoules per centimeter square. And after exposing, the wafer was manually developed in the CD26 developer. So after the developing part is completed, you can see here that the LOR develops in a different way as compared to the positive photoresist. There is an undercut that's formed here. This undercut is very crucial during the liftoff process. So after the patterning process was done, the next was the deposition process, for which the wafer was loaded into a thermal evaporator and the copper was deposited at a very high vacuum, low pressure environment at about 10 power minus 7 torr. So after the copper was deposited, this is what the cross section of the final wafer structures look like. The final process after this was the liftoff on the ultrasonic bench. So the wafer was placed in the ultrasonic bench and at 40 degrees Celsius using NMP solution, the final liftoff was carried out. And this is the final cross section of the copper structures that we obtained. Here is the peak of the actual vapor that completed all the previously mentioned process steps. And each die on the wafer is having all these test structures that were shown in the layout previously. So here is the test setup that we did for testing all the chips on the previous silicon wafer. The parameter analyzer that we used was the HP4145, which is shown right here. And the testing setup is something as follows. We have the test structure, which is the copper or the, which is the copper wire. And we used SMUs or the sensing and measurement units with the parameter analyzer to force current and measure the corresponding voltages. So we made use of four SMUs in total. The SMUs 1 and 2 were used to force current through the structure, while the SMUs 3 and 4 were used to measure the voltage voltages at different points. And using all this data, we calculated the resistance of the wire using this formula. So the parameter analyzer has compliance limits of 20 volts. So while we are setting up the current, we need to make sure that the voltage does not go more than 20 volts. So although we had a variety of different lengths of wires, we decided to test only three lengths of wires of 600, 800 and 1600 micron lines in order to obey the compliance limits of the equipment that we were using. The width of all these three lengths of wires was 1 micron, and the deposition thickness that we obtained was about 0.25 microns. 100 milliamps of current was passed, was forced through all these wires, the 1600, 800 and 600 micron wires. And 100 milliamps of current passing through these wires gets a current density of about 40 megaamps per centimeter square. So this was the current density that we consistently applied across all the different wires to calculate for the electromigration failure times. So here is these are also the microscopic images of the actual wires that we tested. So here is the final electromigration failure time results that we obtained after testing a sample of different lengths of copper wires. The box plot over here shows the distribution of the failure time for each wire length. The 600 micron line, based on the distributions obtained, the 600 micron line had a median time to failure of approximately 71 minutes. The 800 micron line failed at a median time of 51 minutes. And the 1600 micron line, which is the largest line, failed at around 20 minutes. As the length of the wire increased, the failure time decreased and the resistance of the wire was also increasing. So the trend that can be observed over here, where the electromigration medium failure time tends to decrease with increasing length, is actually called as the bleach effect. Now the bleach effect is such that when a shorter wire is applied with a high current density, then the metal atoms which are migrated by the electrons are undergone, have a high reverse mechanical stress built within them that causes those migrated atoms to remigrate back to their original position. So as a result, the voids that were formed were now suppressed back because the atoms that were previously migrated have come back. So this mechanical stress that the atoms tend to experience within a wire increases with decreasing lengths. So as a result of that, as the length of the wire increases, the failure time tends to decrease even more. Another observation that we can make over here is the variance that we can observe in the distribution of the failure times decreases as the resistance or the length of the wire keeps on increasing. So the shorter the length of the wire, the longer the length of the wire, the lesser variance we observe in the EM failure distribution. Now this bleach effect is something that can be quantified using the model shown right here. So this bleach model can be used to model by testing the wires to get their breakdown current density values by using an equipment that has a greater current and voltage capabilities. All these wires that we tested had a breakdown current density of greater than 40 megaamps per centimeter square, which was the maximum limit of our equipment used. So by using another equipment of greater current density limits, we can try to quantify this bleach effect. So here is the failure mechanism that the wires followed for electromigration failure. So shown here is a 1600 micron line that was put under high current stress of 40 megaamps per centimeter square. And while this wire was applied under high current stress, we inspected the wires at different time intervals to see how the wire's structures tend to change. So here is the beginning image of the 1600 micron line. It's clear and concise. And once it's applied into high current stress, it was inspected again at t is equal to 14 minutes. At this point, you can see that voids have begun to form within the wire right here. And eventually at t is equal to 24 minutes, which is approximately the failure time of the wire of 1600 micron length, you can see that these voids have widened and ultimately the wire fails. So these voids began to form at 14 minutes, and by the time it reached its failure time, these voids tend to widen. Here is a zoom in image of one of the edges. Like I said, we did have 90 degree bends and curved bends in the different structures, but we did not observe any noticeable high EM stress at either of the bends. So once a baseline was successfully established for the copper EM failure times, the next step was to transport the graphene. So this graphene was transferred on the wafer by using a dry film transfer process, which was recently developed. This was done by using a graphene on copper foil, which was purchased from the graphene supermarket. The foil was first oxidized in deionized water overnight, and later it was laminated onto a PVA film. Once the graphene transfers over the PVA, the PVA film is then laminated. The PVA film now contains the graphene, is then laminated over the silicon wafer as shown here. So this is the cross section of the expected wafer. You should have the PVA with the graphene over it, laminated over the wafer. And the final step would be to soak the final wafer with the PVA over it in deionized water overnight to get rid of the excess PVA residue. All these laminations can be done using a simple office laminator. The laminator speed should be between 20 to 25 centimeter per minute, and the temperature should be around 110 degrees Celsius. Depending on how well the PVA adheres to the wafer, you might have a need to have multiple laminating passes too. So here is the final image of the transfer that we did over our wafer. This is the area. It is a 1 by 1 inch area of graphene on copper foil that we transferred over the wafer. And here is an image. So once the graphene is transferred, it can be detected using Raman spectroscopy. The Raman plot for graphene has peak intensities at the wave numbers of 1583 and 2643.8 centimeter inverse. The 2D peak, the second peak, which occurs at 2643, is higher than the first G peak, which implies that the graphene that was transferred is actually a monolayer graphene. So even though we were successfully able to transfer the graphene, there were still some issues that needed to be worked upon. The graphene layer was not found to be quite continuous. Even after soaking in water, there was some excess PVA residue still found on the wafer. And in the process of doing the laminations for the transfer, we also identified that there were some feature damages over this area of the wafer. So some features had broken and stripped off due to the transfer. So these are the microscopic images of the final graphene cap copper structures over the wafer. As you can see, as it can be seen here, the PVA residue still exists, and the graphene that was transferred is not continuous across the entire area of transfer. So after the graphene transfer was successful on the wafer, we measured the final electromigration failure time for these graphene capped wires. So these are the failure time results for the 600 micron lines. The mean time to failure for the 600 micron lines was approximately 114 minutes as compared to just the 72 minute failure time for its non-graphene copper counterpart. So there was a difference of 42 minutes for the graphene capped copper wire to fail before its after its copper counterpart failed. So the resistance also for this graphene capped wire decreased. So So the 600 micron line copper wire had a resistance of 40.78 ohms, while the graphene cap 600 micron line had a resistance of 36.4 ohms. So there was a resistance reduction of 10.74%. So similarly, we also did the test for the 1600 micron line, and we found that the failure time for the graphene cap 1600 micron line was 90 minutes as compared to a failure time of 26 minutes for the copper line, which was also of 1600 micron length. The resistance also decreased from 116 ohms before the transfer to 100 ohms after the transfer. So again, there was a resistance reduction of around 13.79% for this line as well. Now, since the graphene that we transferred was just transferred but not etched, there is a possibility that the total current that was actually being forced through the wire was divided between the graphene cap copper wire and the graphene blanket that was spread across the wire, something as shown here. So these were the pads across which the current was forced. But however, the current could have been divided between the wire and the graphene. So based on these resistance values that we obtained for the graphene cap counterparts, and the graphene was transferred over the copper wafer, we tried to calculate the resistance of the graphene as shown here. So based on our calculations, we found that for the 600 micron lines, the resistance of the graphene sheet was around 338.9 ohms. And similarly for the 1600 micron lines, the graphene resistance was about 725 ohms. So based on the electromigration failure time that we were able to observe for the copper as well as the graphene cap copper wires, it can be implied that the graphene did impact the EM reliability of these copper wires. But there can be two ways in which the graphene could have possibly affected these wires. The first way could be that the graphene could have divided the current that was actually being forced through the wire, as it was shown in the previous slides. So due to this, the effective current density to the actual wire decreased, which in turn caused an increase in the failure time. Or another option could be that the graphene actually decreased the surface diffusion of the copper atoms that happened to affect the failure time, or it could have been both too. So the graphene cap did reduce the resistance, as previously mentioned, for the 600 micron lines by 10.74 and for the 1600 micron lines by 13.79%. However, the future work that would be done on the characterization of these graphene wires can give a better idea about how the graphene actually behaved in terms of the EM reliability. So as part of the future work, graphene can be patterned or etched using oxygen plasma, and the sheet resistance and the breakdown current density of those graphene lines could be measured. Oxide can be deposited over the graphene using the TEOS method, and then it can be etched to better define the dimensions of the graphene devices as shown in this cross section. This will help us to more accurately determine what the width and the length of the graphene layer could actually be below the copper wire. So as part of the conclusions, the electromigration failure times of the copper wires and the graphene cap counterparts were successfully measured, and they were compared against each other. An improvement was definitely observed for the graphene cap devices. But however, the exact role that was played by graphene can be investigated further by doing some of the following future work that we just mentioned about. So that would help to understand how exactly the graphene positively impacted the electromigration failure time. And on the other hand, the graphene transfer could also be improved. The process could be slightly improved to get a better quality of graphene layer, a more continuous graphene layer, and try to get lesser residue and PVA, lesser feature damages over the wafer. These are some of the things that can be looked forward to. So I would like to sincerely thank Dr. Robert Pearson and Dr. Ivan Puchades for their consistent help and support throughout the course of this project. And I would also like to say thanks to William Huang, who is a PhD candidate in EME, and Sean O'Brien from the SMFL staff for their help with some of the processing work that was involved inside the SMFL. So So that was all from my side. Thanks a lot for being in the presentation.